Yes.
All right, we're going to go ahead and start. It's about 7 o'clock on Wednesday, June the 26th, 2024. Welcome everyone to the Kensington Municipal Advisory Council meeting for June of 2024. To my right is David Peterson. My name is Lloyd Cowell. To my left, immediate left, is Adam Navickas. And to his left is Ruel Cook. We have a quorum. I think I'm expecting a couple more members to show up, but we'll go ahead and get started nonetheless. The second item on the agenda is citizens' comments, which means anyone and everyone can speak on behalf of anything that relates to community issues, but is not connected directly with any items on the agenda. So citizens' comments, anybody. So longtime followers of the channel will know that 215 Yale is the address that's being considered for development. We have not heard anything yet from the county. That's the same as last month. So as soon as we do, or if we do, we'll make sure that that project is scheduled to the next available AMAC meeting. But it's not on the agenda tonight. I also don't have anything for July yet, so tonight we have two projects that we're going to consider. One is on Willamette Avenue, and it's new construction. The second one is 262 Lake Drive, which is, I guess we have to retroactively consider something that's already constructed, where it increased the square footage of the building until it requires a public hearing. And normally we hear these in, we consider it as if the project had not been built and we were being asked to recommend approval or denial of a plan rather than already constructed. We've been joined by Ben Barry, so the more the merrier. The reason I bring up the particular projects before approval of the meeting notes is because we think we're going to go ahead and try to take 262 Lake Drive out of order, because I think most of the people who are attending tonight are more interested in the Willamette Avenue project, and it will probably a fair bit of time to get through. I previously distributed the meeting notes relating to the May 29th, 2024 meeting by email several weeks ago to members of the board. Does anybody have any questions or comments or corrections to the meeting notes from May 29th?
Make a motion to approve the meeting notes from May 29th.
Second.
All right, all those in favor? We are moving along. All right, so let's call 262 Lake Drive. Is anybody here for 262 Lake Drive? No Scandinavia. Anybody home? No. We're joined by Bill. Well, we're trying to get through 262 Lake Drive, and we're just asking if there's anybody here wants to talk about it. I don't hear anybody. It's not required, so it's just for you. Good.
Well, we can just we'll have it first. So stuff may come later.
That's also true. And we're not going to, no need to sit and wait for someone who may step away for a moment. We know that we're back out of the country and the time difference means that to see Two Lake Drive people are, it's 4 in the morning where they are. So, all right, so let's talk about what's currently numbered 0 Willamette Avenue. The applicant seeks approval of a Kensington Design Review Development Plan and the variance for a 0 front yard setback, a 0 foot front yard setback where 20 feet is required, for a new 4,722 square foot single family residence where 3,000 square feet is the maximum gross floor area allowed on a vacant lot. The project also includes a tree permit for a code protected tree that was previously removed. All right. So it's, who's here to talk about, to present first on the Zero Willamette project?
As somebody who's got concerns, or as the homeowner,
property owner, or the project person, like often
the project as the architect?
As the architect, absolutely. That happens all the time. While he's getting ready, the way we'll do this is that they will present to the board. The board will answer questions. Then we'll throw it open to the community for them to speak and have questions if necessary. Then the meeting closes. We don't go anywhere, but we close the meeting, have an internal discussion that everybody can hear. And then we have a vote. I'm only asking, since there's a lot of people here, please take turns, don't talk over each other. If you're speaking, please address your comments to the board and not each other. And try not to repeat yourself. So thanks very much. Please go ahead. Hello.
Hi. Thanks for having me. I'm the architect for the project. And I live locally. I'm in the same zip code as Kensington in Buffy Hills. So to be as brief as possible, this is an overall representation of the project, which is a site section. So it's as if the land was cut on the east side to show you the entire project, because it's not fully visible from the street, and this explains it best. The building that we're proposing steps back up the hill. That is partially to ensure that we have the two-story maximum at any given area per Kensington code. And it's also to reduce the massing as seen from the street, but to reduce the amount of house that can be visible from the street. The lot is owned by Dean Gridley, who's here. And the house is in two parts and will be occupied by Dean and his nephew and his nephew's family. I'll take you through the three parts of the house. The upper portion, which is in saturated and the rest is desaturated, is the main house, which is 2966 square feet. It's for a family of six. So the parents have a bedroom suite in the back. Each of these windows is a kid's room that's about 9 foot 10 by 10 foot 10. Those two rooms share a bathroom. There are two more kids, the upstairs first. There is a living space here, which contains an open plan living kitchen and dining area. The entry to this two-story structure is on this lower level. And these two windows are the other two kids' bedrooms, also 9 foot 10 by 10 foot 10. And in the front is a family room slash kids' room. So that house for a family of six is a total of 5 bedrooms and 3 full baths. Next down is the ADU, which would be where Dean would live, also known as an in-law unit. I had some confusion about the term ADU, so just so you know, ADU, in-law, same thing. It has one 11 foot by 12 foot bedroom, another 11 foot by 12 foot office slash guest room, which is counted as a bedroom by code, and 18 by 16 foot living, dining, and kitchen area. Again, one open plan, one space. The lower level, which is in the front setback, is a garage for 3 off-street parking spaces. 2 spaces are required by Kensington zoning or contractor zoning for any project. One is a voluntary space that the clients want to have for the ADU, so that ADU also has off-street parking. The ADU rules don't require off-street parking when you're within, I think it's a quarter mile of a transit stop or a bus stop, but it's being provided in the project. One of the, so I was asked to work on the project sort of midstream, and I was told about view issues from 144 Purdue, which borders the back of the lot. And we also noticed a corner window at 255 Willamette, which is right next door, just on the east side of the lot. And so to take you through some of the mitigation that we did there, the owners of 144 Purdue bought the lot, bought their house from the same owners who sold this lot, and has had instituted a view easement, which is what we call the deeded height limit, that was lower than the Contra Costa maximum allowable height. And so early on, we were told that despite the deeded height limit, those neighbors were concerned about their view, and we would try to mitigate that as much as possible. So we ended up with our structure 4.5 feet, which is approximately half a story below the deeded height limit that the property came with. I have been to I've been to 144 Purdue a few times. Thanks to Arjun and Sarah for having me over. And with the story poles that we've put up lately, this is a sketch, a pencil sketch from the story poles showing the amount of roof that would be visible from their living room and from their entry. I hope it shows that it's fairly minimal and that we propose that we can put plantings within my client's lot that would abut the roof, and if they were allowed to grow up to about 5 feet, would hide this roof completely, hoping to continue that view for them of a sort of natural landscape of the city beyond.
So the red is the view impact?
The red would be the roof, the proposed roof. I drew that with a pencil with the story called as a marker. The other issue is 255 Willamette, which is the house immediately east or slightly uphill to my client's lot. And they have four windows that are on their west elevation, so look upon this lot directly. The front window is a corner living room window. There is a dining room window, a kitchen window, and a study window. I haven't been to this house, but I did have a conversation over Zoom and a nice email exchange with the owners. And so we talked about this a little bit. This is an elevation drawing. So it sort of collapses this facade onto that facade. And so it's a little bit misleading in that you don't get the space in between the two houses, which I hope the other next two slides will help. This is an image we found on Zillow of the living room. And you can see that blue cone there represents the camera angle that this image was that represents the what you see in the actual photo, and the purple lines here are the outline of the house as proposed. So I'll show you another Zillow shot. In both cases, from this angle, which is fairly deep in the living room, fairly to the side, the house will be hidden from. Will not obstruct their primary view out to the bay. Where are we? The next issue is the dining room window, which looks directly onto the middle of the existing vacant lot. And the issue there, I believe, is the sunlight. As we looked at the sun angle, chose the equinox as the average for the year. The sun angle direct sunlight comes into the house until 5 p.m. on the equinox. Yes.
Which
summer.
Equinox meaning March 21st or September 21st.
So
yeah,
no difference.
Fall. Yeah. The other two windows, the kitchen window and the study window, that's a photograph of their house from the site, are behind a fence that has some vines growing on it. And so we don't believe that our house is further away still from the proposed design is further away still from the fence. So I believe those windows will receive more or less the same kind of light and air that they do now. So back to a proposed design. 255 Willamette is on the right that we were just talking about. The proposed design requests the garages to be in the front yard setback. This is an uphill slope. It is very steep in the front. It actually has a small retaining wall. And to put garages that are set within the setback would require that entire 20-foot section to be removed, which is an awful lot of earthwork and would require retaining walls on either side of the property to hold up 255 and the neighbor to the west. So we're requesting the front yard setback to minimize the disruption of the topography, and it has precedence along the street with the neighbor and houses further down and up the road. The massing has been designed to try to minimize the presence on the street. The upper level is actually invisible from the street perspective that I'm showing, which is a little bit actually higher than eye level from directly across the street in this case. One of the aspect hills, I've lived here 8 years, is the intermingling of foliage and architecture that sort of gives the hills this character. The trees going up the slopes and the houses climbing up the slopes and allowing both to exist with each other. And one of the things that we did was to keep the house narrow on the east side of the lot so that a western terrace could allow for, in this case, a tree growing in the middle of the lower level. You wouldn't see from the street foliage growing above, but those are all plantable areas. The planters as well, along the upper deck and the middle deck and the ADU deck are designed to be deep, up to 24 inches deep and wide, so that any number of plants could be grown that could gain a significant enough size to contribute to that fabric of the hills. Last is two perspectives at eye level again, looking from up the street down Willamette and from down the street up to Willamette. The existing houses are white outlines. The proposed structure is in the beige stucco that we're proposing for the project. Almost all of the greenery you see here is existing, and none of it is planned to be altered as part of the renovation. The additions to the greenery would be in the planter boxes, as you see up there. And you I think the other perspective shows you, the street level perspective shows you the tree planters up above. I think that's a fairly complete summary. Is there anything I missed, Steve?
No, I think you covered most of the issues. I just know our first plan kind of covered the whole width of the lot. And I had my old architect do that. Jasmine's made a not upper building where it only comes in about 2/3. So there's a huge corridor space, you know, between our neighbor there. Other side is minimal, but, you know, but that also helps reduce any blockage of his view above. Not all of it, but I mean, it used to be all, now we're down to 60% of it. So that helped. We tried to do as much as we could, you know, to make that view issue of you know, as minimal as we can. Our first project, it actually cut in quite a bit more than I would have thought. If you're standing on the ground, you wouldn't perceive it. And, you know, until we went over to Arjun's house and looked at it, I realized, wow, it's an unusual thing. You don't perceive that would happen. The main problem is his house is just on the top of the hill that starts to curve. And so in a way, he's not pitched like the rest of us. So it kind of makes him a little lower in a sense, as far as the way his view angle is. But, you know, we lowered the ceiling heights to 8 feet, the minimum, and we tried to do that. We dug into the hill more to bring it down as much, you know, anywhere if you look at that side view, you'll see the two floors are like almost half of it's in the hill. You know, it's below ground. So we really worked on trying to do what we can. You know, I mean, I think we're kind of out of options. It's what else we could do that would, you know, improve that even better. But that's about all I can tell you.
Do you want to leave this up or take it?
Go ahead. Yeah. We're going to first away board members who have questions or comments, and then we'll throw it open to the floor.
Yeah.
There's comments in the letters about stairs on the sidewalk. Is that something you can?
Well, I can talk about that a little bit. So, but as you know, the Willamette is fairly steep. And so the way we made these three parking spots work was with two driveways at different heights, because there's a maximum 11% slope a driveway can have. So from the street to the garage, we can only have 11%. And that sets the bottom of the garage from the street. And so to have three parking spots, we made one slope here and another slope here. And between them, there needs to be a grade change. We've offered two options to Public Works. One is a ramp and the other is stairs. I've been told by Grant that they have looked at it, thought that it was okay. Which one they want to have us do, I don't know yet. But it's one of the options we presented as really an option.
What's the story about the code protected tree?
So
I don't see that a lot.
Yeah, there was, this is before my clients owned it. There were trees on the property that were cut down without a permit, I believe. We showed with Google Earth images that it happened before my clients bought the property, so they have no knowledge that there had been trees there. There are some there now that have grown, but with Google Earth, we figured out when they were cut down, because there was tree and then there was no tree. But that happened a couple of years before. So
yeah,
that draft,
what year was
that? I think it was, what was it now? 2011?
Yeah, it was a while back.
Yeah.
Wow.
I know the person that did.
Somebody must pay.
Enough.
All I know about it is what we discovered by Google Earth.
You didn't know. You just did the work.
Anybody else have questions for the presenter?
So there are some comments also, and I know this is going to come up in the degree, but roofing material, do you know what that's going to be at this point?
It will have to be a full roof, and I'm proposing modified bitumen, which has a full roof option.
Yeah.
It is a whitish speckled material.
And reflective light and stuff like that?
It diffuses light. It's supposed to reflect infrared from the intuitive space. That's what I'm going to do. But it looks like a speck of white. I'd say off-white, but.
Now, how far is the proposed garage front sighted from the edge of the sidewalk?
Could you measure that? It's the width of the sidewalk, which I think is about 10 feet. It's an interesting position. Kensington has a gutter, a concrete gutter, and then the curb, then the planter, and then the sidewalk. So our driveway would come from the front of the property line to the edge of the gutter, to the street edge of the gutter. So that exact dimension we can give you in a second.
Is there a sidewalk existing there now?
There's a sidewalk
there. How far back from that existing sidewalk is the garage site?
It is on that edge.
Now, you said that there are precedents for this setback in the neighborhood. Can you point just any examples?
Yes.
Give us an idea how many.
If you can give me a second.
It's actually one next to our neighbor, Larry. He's one, and another one is on, let's see, it was on our street, it was on another street, it was about a block away, mm-hmm. where they allowed that. The Larry just finished up, he's what's his address, 245. So
239 Williamette and 245 Williamette.
So we're neighbors. Same.
239 is not up against the sidewalk.
This is from Grant Farrington.
It's my house.
Not against the sidewalk. In front of the garage, we have 3'11" and 5/8" of an inch.
To the edge of what?
The edge of the curb. To the gutter.
What's the honorable driveway?
Our overall driveway.
If you look at that section.
And there have been story poles up. I just haven't had a chance to walk by.
There are story poles with the two corners you don't see in this rendering.
On the upper level.
Yeah, so
it's not a full set.
It is not a full set. There are story poles. At this corner, at that far corner, and at the two corners of the back of the house.
Okay, so just the very top.
Correct. Primarily because the view from 144th that you was the would say big issue.
The entire driveway is 12'1".
12 feet from is the driveway length.
That's not
that wasn't my question. My question.
Nothing to do with that.
Yeah. The question is where it is it? It is right on the top of you.
Right on the side. And how much the picture you showed with the sunlight on the east neighbor's
house? Yep.
Coming into their window.
Yep.
At what time of day is that?
This is 5 p.m. on the equinox.
5 p.m.
Yeah.
Okay. Good.
And at this point, the entire window is receiving full sunlight.
I see. Yes.
Okay. I'm sure we'll have more questions, but
yeah, do you want to hear from you want to hear from everybody else now and then come back to it?
Yeah.
Can I ask another question? The next door neighbor, that guy right there, his garage is right on the sidewalk as well.
No. The one that's on the east.
Right. That's why okay, yeah. The one on the east.
No.
So his garage. Well, the neighbor, his garage is right on the sidewalk, right?
Cool.
So you're proposing to put your garage front parallel to his.
I don't think
the
inverter is here.
Yeah, no, it's not. About 7 feet back.
Yeah.
From the sidewalk?
Yeah.
So it's
like from the property?
On the edge.
7 feet from the sidewalk, from the property.
I'm just talking about the sidewalk. I'm talking about property.
Let me just check one thing then. if you have more questions, I can do.
Well, some of the, I think where we're going, some of the correspondence has been raised concern about the proximity of the garage doors, just to make it clear, to the sidewalk. And I think that's the question you're getting at is like how many houses have the garage literally on top of the sidewalk.
Yeah, as you can be consistent
and
with that.
And it's also going to change the grade. Right. Of the sidewalk, it sounds like based on how that's designed, and there were some concerns over creating an uphill place where there wasn't one
right.
For people, you know, elderly folks who
right.
can take a lot of walks.
So none of this sidewalk is ADA compatible. And so one of the reasons we offered this a set of three steps rather than a steep ramp was to make that an easier to transverse, fabulous walkway.
And so if I understand correctly, you know, the sidewalk would come up and then level out for the first garage entrance that's single and then—
It does have a slope, but it's a much lighter slope.
Oh, okay. Oh, I've seen that.
Can you show the front view of the garage?
Yeah. Please? So we're allowed to have a cross slope on the driveway. So we've maximized that as far as possible so that we can, you know, obviously we have a starting point here and a finishing point here or vice versa. And easing that as much as possible is the intention.
So for the sidewalk
within the codes.
Sorry. Yeah. Okay. but it, from the far left to the far right, it's one continuous slope, or it's broken up.
It's broken up into
the five garage door differences. That's what Heather has, a steeper slope.
That would happen. That steepest slope would happen between the two garage doors here, okay. And that's where we're offering three steps. Or
how about on the uphill side at the end? Is there additional compensation for the slope? Do you, where it joins back in front of your neighbor's house?
I don't think there is very much. I think we use that as a starting point. And so, I mean, we can only affect the sidewalk that's in front of the property. So the two starting points are the property line current height and the property line current height. And in between that, we've tried to shape what can allow for the three-car garage.
So you're not talking about steep ramps or stairs at the property line.
Not at the end.
Side. It's just the one
in the middle.
And it's, you said that that could be taken care of with three normal size steps.
Correct. That you're talking about. Three quite gentle steps.
So just trying to understand.
And have you considered, since this is a concern for some of the older residents in the area, have you considered at all other accommodations to help people up at, like, maybe handholds in the facade or something like that? I'm not trying to design a project, but
no, for sure we would have to put a rail.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
There are two sets of steps on the place.
There are two sets of steps?
Yeah.
No, there's one set of steps on the sidewalk. The other steps go up toward the house.
What's the second set of steps that you're having?
I can share that same drawing.
Yeah. Do you want to do it or
what? Well, if you could, because it will go into the recording, it's fine. We just want to make sure that we're all talking about the same thing.
You're right. We did draw an option for a second steps, but this is the concern isn't so much here. Let me share this.
Yeah.
This is the version with the slopes. This is a steeper slope in the middle, which is where we suggested the three steps. We also drew these in as an option. That is correct.
And so when that second optional set of stairs that you're indicating now is still on the subject property.
Right? Correct. Okay. Right.
What's the... and so in order to get that corner of the double garage opening, there has to be, it looks like you're bringing the grade down, level it, and then have it to constantly go back up.
So there's two sections where the grade's going to be increased.
Yes.
Okay. So, and both are either going to be stairs or the ramp.
One can be stairs, one can be a ramp, both can be stairs, both can be.
Many combinations of
both. Yes.
All right.
And both would have ramp railings installed.
Both would have to have railings, yeah.
Okay.
So I want to get that. I want to get.
At my age, I'm a 3 foot water.
Yeah. Cool. We're not opening the subject. We're not opening the public discussion.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Just yet. No, it's fine. We're still trying to drill down a couple things.
Okay, I'll shut up.
No.
I got it.
Now, just hold your thought. No, be quiet. Just for a sec.
I'm still trying to get the location of this up there. Front edge of the front of the garage in reference to the sidewalk and the neighbor. So you're saying that the front of this garage is right on the edge of the sidewalk, which is the edge of the property line, I understand. Mm-hmm. Is the neighbor's garage right on the sidewalk? Are there any garages right on the sidewalk, directly to the left or to the right of this proposed garage? It's my question.
I don't have on the surveyor's plan the front of that garage.
Yeah, but you can buy there a long time. So, the gas would be
Mm-hmm. They're all set back. That's the ones. I mean, two houses down.
Okay. So they're all set back. But how much? 2 feet.
I think. I mean, Larry said 7. Mine's probably close to what Larry's is.
Yours is a little further back.
A little further back than the one up the hill is way up the driveway.
Okay.
And then I can't remember the rest, but.
And I guess my only comment.
They do.
Well, I have two comments. Number one, this garage would be closer to the street than the neighboring properties. Second, if you did place the garage back further, you would improve the condition at the stairs that you've proposed between the two garages there, because you get additional slopes from sweep into the driveway.
What?
So my question then would be, did you consider moving the garage back 3 or 4 feet from the property line, from the sidewalk?
So the there's two issues. One is how much room is there here, right between the garage and the sidewalk?
Yeah, you should see where
and the other, so here basically, right? And the other is the driveway ramp and what that does to the sidewalk. The driveway ramp starts at the street, which we can do nothing about. And the driveway ramp has a limited slope of 11%. So as if the street is this and the driveway makes a slope up, the difference in height of the driveways is set by the slope of the street.
I understand. My question is, have you considered moving the garage back to increase the distance over which you have to...
It would increase the distance, but it wouldn't change the shape of the sidewalk. And the reason it doesn't change the shape of the sidewalk is because our start point is the street and the slope of the street. So if our street slopes this way and we have a driveway corner point here, the next corner point is also set by the street.
Because the sidewalk is a fixed distance from the street, and you're going to have to deal with it regardless of how far.
So what's there now?
Sorry?
So what's there now?
No driveways.
Right? Yeah, but what about the street?
I'm not following.
The street and the sidewalk. Does the sidewalk have stairs in it now?
It doesn't have stairs in it now. But there's no curb cuts. There's no driveway going across them.
The sidewalk's pretty high above the street at that point.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I see. There's a hill going up to the side.
That's right.
Okay.
My point is on
merely suggesting that at some point, if you move the garage back, it would increase the ease with which you could handle that sidewalk situation.
Because
you're talking about the whole property line. What is it, a 50-foot property?
Yeah, it's 56, I think.
Yeah, so you could, you know, start with a nice smooth sweep down.
The what I'm saying is, because of the slope of the street, the points at which the driveway hit it are decided by the street. And so if those driveways have a limited slope of 11%, then I have to have a space between them that makes up for that.
Okay.
So moving the garages back would give you more room away from the sidewalk, but it doesn't change the slope from the street to that sidewalk point. That makes sense.
Talking about two different.
Yeah.
I'm down. That's fine.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. So we're going to hear from people first in the room. If you're on Zoom, congratulations. We will get to you, and everybody's thoughts and feelings about the project are equally valid. So, who would like to go first here in the room? Can you tell us your name, sir?
My name is Arvind Singh. I'm 145 with
you. You live right next door, right?
Not next door, but about it.
Okay.
And I just have one question. Why? What's that? My campus, even on Zoom, if you work till 7.
Hey,
is there any chance you could go right after me? Or
absolutely. All right.
Do you want to
thanks.
Yeah, you take this off.
I appreciate it.
Okay, so the code is important to me. We made a substantial investment in our dream home, and a major factor in our purchase price was the preservation of our view, our enjoyment, and our property value that the code provides. The code says the development will promote general welfare, public health, and safety of the community, and that the evaluation will judge the compatibility with corrected bulk and scale and design of the development and more. And it clearly says that this will not result in the prohibition of a development that is compatible with the neighborhood. Unfortunately, this development is incompatible with the neighborhood in regard to bulk and scale. The proposed development will be an extreme outlier, and this drives a lot of the decisions and a lot of the kind of variant, the one variant and a lot of issues come up with the property. At 4722 square feet, it would be nearly twice as large as the average in Willamette. It's 1700 square feet and 1.5, over 1.5 times larger than the 3000 square foot threshold, which is a much larger deviation than anything nearby. The floor area ratio would be over 25%, about 28%, the average in Willamette, and that includes the garages. This is using the county data. The county land use element states that the expected density for a property in this zone is 12.5 to 22 people per acre. This development will be 39 to 44, which is twice the top end of the range. And there's precedent. I've searched through several KMAC approvals and denials, and on similar sized lots, KMAC previously recommended a max floor area of 3,300 and 3,600, which are only 500 to 800 in excess of the threshold. The max of that is 30%. I've been unable to find anything coming anywhere close to 1,700 at 57%. I think we need story pulls. I believe there are specific impacts to our home, several neighbors, and the overall neighborhood, including garage issues. I hope I'm wrong, but I don't believe it's possible to fully evaluate the impacts without a full set of accurate story pulls with horizontal markers. And I've been asking and encouraging those to be put up before we have this discussion. So hopefully we find that the impacts are actually not as big as we might be worried about. Although I believe that the bulk, scale, and size should be enough to deny the application, I believe that at a minimum, we should assess the impacts with story pulls before approving it. And the last thing for me is that the project could actually get bigger than it is with no further review. Although the architect presented the plan for an ADU, what is being requested today is a 4,700 square foot single family residence. And I fully believe the intention of the applicant to convert the interior space, but there is no guarantee that that happens. Plans can change, owners can change, and if that happens and it's approved as is, nothing prevents the addition of another ADU or conversion of the garage to an ADU, and there will be no review of that after this approval. One remedy is the applicant could submit alternative plans to the smaller residence and then add the ADU afterwards, which is the thing that the county process is supposed to work. That is not what this proposal does. It starts with a large residence and does not guarantee the ADU conversion. And it's okay, I'll just have my wife go and just have the slides.
Can I just have a quick question before you go? There would be a review process if there's a conversion of the garage. That is my understanding, because that's converting, because that's not living space. And so it'd be a significant change in the square footage of the property and would require review.
The 2024 code, I believe, changed that.
Yeah.
Yes,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Have you heard the news?
Okay. All right.
I don't know either way. So whether an ADU is proposed in the initial plan or if the house is set up in such a way that an ADU is possible, that I think our job is to look into the future because...
Oh, absolutely. I'm just trying to make sure, like, I think your point about the ADU, I understand that. The garage is more where I was curious because that's not official living space usually. And so it changes the living space if you convert that to living space.
So I talked to the planner today and I asked him about this issue specifically. And he said we should consider this as a 4,700 square foot residence.
Uh-huh.
And this application does not have an ADU. Although, again, I fully am not going to doubt the intentions.
Yeah.
But he told me if this gets approved, there is nothing that can guarantee that happens, and there will not be a further ADU afterwards.
Yeah, no, and that's accurate. You know, like if the family decides to sell it at some point and the next owner converts it and puts it all together, that's absolutely true.
And the ADU or the story poles that you were talking about, which part of that? I mean, the house sort of steps back and goes up the slope, so which part is the part's sticking point?
Well, for me, it's a little bit difficult to kind of assess the full impact of the roof and the glare from. So the pictures we showed are sort of the smallest view impact in the home. Mm-hmm. Probably the most important one for us. I do appreciate the work that's been done to minimize it. But there's several other rooms that have larger view impacts and several rooms that would get potential glare if we can't mitigate it into essentially every single room in the house. And those ones, the roof's much bigger and the poles and the ribbons or the ribbons would help a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And then, others will kind of say they're, like I've heard from a lot of neighbors and I'll leave it to them to kind of share their need for the story poles, but I think the garage is a very common one.
So the glare off the roof, where does that come from? I mean, I have a roof that has heat reflective properties, and it's much lighter than the shingles that we had on there before. But I would have to say, I don't think glare is an issue. So do you think that because of the materials that are planned to be used for making this roof are going to be a source of glare, and why do you think that?
Yeah, so my wiring systems will address it a little bit more, but the main thing is your roof flat?
Well, it's then in the back, it slopes to the one, it's not peaked at all.
Yeah, so the main is the fact that it's flat, and that would mean that when the sun is at a specific spot on a specific day, you're going to get reflections off of it. And then, I mean, the whole point of the cool roof is to reflect heat. And you mentioned to me that it's supposed to diffuse it, but it's hard for me to understand to what degree it reflects it versus diffuses it. But the whole point of the cool roof is it reflects light and heat off the house, so it doesn't enter the house. And if light and heat reflected, where it's going to go, it's going to go into our home.
This is a lot of discussion about this scenario right now in terms of roofing materials, because there's a big push for green roof and energy efficiency and stuff like that. So yes, like, understood your concern. A lot of people are talking about it.
And just want a pitched roof, and I understand a lot of the reasons why a pitched roof is difficult, but a pitched roof would not have nearly the same impact because the angle would be very different.
You'd have to, like, it all depends where what the pitch is and everything like that.
Right, right.
There's plenty of ways that could also reflect more into your home, potentially, depending on what the pitch is. So
fair enough. I think with the angles, I think it'd be much less likely, but it makes sense.
Yeah.
All right, well, I'm going to let your better half go.
There's Sarah there.
Yeah, thanks for letting me add to the discussion afterwards. As we were just talking about, I just wanted to add that I do feel like this development does affect our view and enjoyment and in value of our home. The flat roof is really different from everything else in the neighborhood with regards to design. And as we were just discussing, I think it can result in pretty substantial glare into our main living areas, and especially our home office, where Arjun works from home every day, as shown in the picture below. Without complete story poles, including those horizontal markers, as we've discussed, you know, we really can't fully evaluate what the impact will be on our home. The second thing that I wanted to point out is that when I first walked into our home before we purchased it, I was wowed by the view right when you walk in. And that was the view that the architect showed earlier. It felt private and sweeping, and the new development, as you saw, despite it being small, and again, we were really appreciative of trying to minimize it, but it does add a structure right in the middle of this view. And additionally, with the flat roof, although it's supposed to be inaccessible, anybody can walk up there and then effectively see everywhere into our home. And we've seen neighbors on supposedly inaccessible roofs many times, and a flat roof is much more inviting than any of these others that are pitched. I also feel strongly that the variance that they're asking for makes our neighborhood less safe. A big factor in our choice to purchase a home in Kensington was the great elementary school here. We're expecting our first child in October, and you know, our future kids are going to walk down the street to get to school. And I believe that the modifications in the sidewalk, combined with the 0-foot setback of the garage and this really narrow road, make this walk more dangerous than it is today. Additionally, Kensington is one of the highest fire risk communities in California, and an out-of-scale development with twice the intended density does not support the general welfare, public health, and safety of our neighborhood. And the last thing that I wanted to add was just that I feel strongly that it does change the neighborhood's character. I grew up in a really tiny town in upstate New York, and the small feeling of Kensington felt really like warm and fuzzy and part of the appeal to me. And that's really rare to find in the Bay Area. And even our home, which I know is on the bigger side, only has 4 bedrooms. And it's on a lot that's twice as large as what's being proposed here. So this just doesn't feel like it's in line with the character or design of our area.
All right, thank you very much.
May I?
Sure. Let's go back to the room. And you know, you're up. Come on, let's get it done. We're gonna get it through. Have a hot seat to yourself. Say your piece. And
I prefer to stand. That's okay.
the vote. With the vote on whether you can stay.
Yeah. I'm Anthony Knight from 234 Willamette Avenue. The critical factor of this project is the scale and bulk. To any observer, it is just a technicality that part of the square footage is labeled ADU, additional dwelling unit. To all appearances, this is a 4,700 square foot building and should be considered as such. Not one house on either side of the street approaches these proportions. Of greater concern, after approval, there is nothing to prevent the applicant from using the ADU as personal living space and building an additional ADU later, such as a garage conversion. Another critical factor is that at present, it is not possible for an observer on the street to really assess the impact of the scale and bulk because the applicant has failed to set up a full set of story poles. I feel that all discussion of this project should be postponed until the poles, both vertical and horizontal, are in place. In addition, I feel it reasonable to require that the placement be certified as accurate as is required for projects in the city of Brooklyn. Scale and bulk lead to a whole host of concerns. For instance, the variance request for zero setback. It's not the topography. They also lead to questions about the split level garages and very awkward treatment of the sidewalk, which for the current plans cannot possibly be expected to pass ADA requirements. Housing density is also an issue. A typical three-bedroom residence in the Kensington House area houses a family of four or five with two cars. The cars are typically accommodated in a double garage. The plans for the Willamette project include seven bedrooms. Three garages cannot possibly be expected to accommodate all the vehicles which will be needed by the large number with respect to traffic flow. A large number of people living there. Increased residential density generates increased safety issues with respect to traffic flow, parking, and pedestrians, all of which fall on the existing residents rather than the applicants. Thank you.
All right, thanks very much.
Before we go to the next person, can I just ask a question of Dean? Is there a openness to doing a full set of story polls that have been requested by the neighbors to see like what the actual structure might feel like with like everything in place?
Yeah, we can do it. We did some before the plan we had, and we brought that plan.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, we found it was really hard to distinguish the poles. You know, you lose your depth perception. But you know, yeah, I mean,
it seems like since it sounds like we're going to get some more comments asking from first order polls to better understand what it feels like,
yeah,
with the structure being built. And honestly, what we've noticed in the past is that with large developments, it helps people know, but it might not solve the problems. People might still feel it's too big a structure,
right?
But it might help people, to the same effect, it might help them understand just how big it is and whether or not they can tolerate it.
Sure. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right, who's next? Anybody in the room?
I just have a question.
Sure.
Is there any consideration to perhaps do something smaller scale? I mean, I'm also in Willamette, I'm a neighbor, so it's just out of character. It's so big.
Well, we'll have to direct your comments to the board.
Oh, sorry.
We're not starting a conversation like that, but anyway. So you think that it's too big, right?
It's too big.
Okay.
And then also, to the comment I heard earlier online is we walk there all the time, and there's lots of mothers with strollers. There's lots of families with small children. This is going to be a huge inconvenience on the sidewalk.
Well, the sidewalk would cause problems for pedestrians. Okay. All right. Anything? I'll try it. I'll get to you in a second.
And just as someone who walks Kensington streets every day, I think a garage door right on the sidewalk is so dangerous. I can't imagine that would be allowed. There's a reason why we have setbacks.
So like a garage door that goes bonk like that?
Can you imagine walking on the sidewalk and all of a sudden the garage door right next to you goes up?
Okay, so the garage doors on the sidewalk are the things that,
I can't imagine that would be allowed.
Okay. All right, he's next. What do you got?
My name is Jonathan Walter. I live at 207 Willamette. I've got a question and a comment. I did not understand your earlier comment when you referred to 60% of the view, I believe, from the uphill home. Is that person losing 60% or maintaining 60%?
Talking about me?
Yes, sir.
What I meant was the upper buildings are narrower. They don't take the whole lot. And so it leaves a big... Normal, the first plan we had, it went all the way across.
It's not that complicated. You referred to working to achieve 60%. Keeping 60% of the person's existing view, or did he lose 60% of his or her existence? That's the question.
Whose view are you talking about?
The one that you were talking about, which is the uphill building.
Yeah, so there's an impact on the view, right?
The impact on the view I showed with the pencil drawings that were done up story pulled. So that has had nothing to do with the 60%
of the instructor. That's, I'm trying to get clarity on what 60%. He said that they worked hard to achieve the 60% of the view.
No, I think I didn't say that, but
Well, I think if we go ahead with story polls, which they agree to, then
it remains unanswered. I would submit that if you are in a garage and the garage door is on the immediate perimeter of the sidewalk, and you are backing out until you clear that garage door and your car is at least half, if not three quarters of the way onto the sidewalk, you have no visibility.
It's true.
Coming up and down. I mean, so even if the garage door were to be installed to be a more modern so that it does not swing out, you're still backing out and you're at least three quarters of the way out of the garage before you have visibility on the sidewalk. And young children clearly going back and forth to Kensington School. On the corollary, if you argue, well, I'm going to come out this way, you're still a good third of the way of the car protruding onto the sidewalk without visibility.
All right, it's even worse because modern cars, a lot of them have rear facing cameras, but few of them have front facing. That's an anecdote.
That's an observation. I think it's subjective and valid.
My garage is a 0-foot setback. It just happens to be on Arlington. So I sweat every time I back up. I've had five close calls. I keep track of it, but it's been over 20 years. So.
Were they children or adults?
Joggers and other irresponsible types.
God protects fools and children.
It's a joke. Anyway, but thank you very much for your contribution. Who's next?
Could I follow up with my esteemed neighbor?
Absolutely.
Who I think is on or something. For those who are comfortable doing it, we would prefer if you came up in front of the board when you spoke. If you're not comfortable, that's okay.
Yeah, the webcam is not great, and the sound drop off of the mic.
Thank you, sir. It seems like you've got 7 bedrooms, and if you've ever driven on that street, especially if there's some construction project going on, you don't get by. Or if you do get by, you may have to wait or do something like drive on the sidewalk, which I have actually done. The thing is that you have 7 bedrooms, is that right? 7? Okay, 7 bedrooms to me means eventually 7 cars, because all the kids will have cars. There will be a lot of cars that are sitting on the street. And in Kensington, we have a major problem now. It means that traffic lanes are narrow, the streets are narrow, because no one, at least not very many people that I know of, use their garages for parking cars. They put their stuff in there, but the cars go on the street. So to me, that means that you may have issues blocking the street with your cars, because it's narrow and it's very steep.
And you think it's going to get worse in the future?
Maybe. Who knows? And then you've got construction trucks, concrete trucks, you're going to be pouring a lot of concrete. You're going to be moving a lot of dirt. That means to me a lot of dump trucks,
trying to get in and out of that very narrow street. I think construction is going to be a bit miserable for everybody, including yourselves, if you're the owners. I don't know. Are you the owners?
No, we're the board.
Oh, you're the board.
Everyone on the board is a Kensington property owner, but we're not associated with this particular project.
I see. Yeah. Well, I hardly ever go to these meetings. So I apologize. I don't know who is who. I would say that the other thing is that the house is looking interesting. I think that there's some good designers behind it, and it, I think, bears some further development. It has a lot of promise. Whether or not it cuts out the views from people up on top, I can't tell. And I don't think anyone can really, really objectively make a decision until they see the, what do you call them, the barge boards or the sticks that go up. If you're from Switzerland, you would know what that really means. They're very tight, very domineering about how you build these things, where you put them, and exactly defines all the corners of the house and the peaks on the roofs. So that's something that I think you might want to explore further before you make your minds up. And then I had a question for the designers. So I don't know who that is. Sir, is that a driveway going up behind the first story of the house? It's not. Okay. I'm relieved because that's a steep hill. It would be a nice idea if you could do that, but well, it'd be very difficult to pull off. And then finally, I think speaking as an architect, you need to trust your architect eventually with all of these comments. He is probably listening very carefully and probably trying very hard to give you what everyone wants. It'll be a compromise. No one will get exactly what you want, but it looks like you can do that. So go for it, man. Thanks.
Are you also an architect, sir?
I was. I'm retired.
You practice here in the
I practice on my house now.
I'm working projects.
Yeah.
Good luck with that.
All right. Thanks. Who's next?
Go for it.
Good evening. I'm Lynn Wolter. I live at 207 Willamette Avenue. I had the distinction of being appointed by John Gioia to serve on what was then known as the Small Lot Ordinance, working with Jim Carman, who was once president of this organization. The reason the Small Lot Ordinance came to be is because prior to the 2008 financial meltdown, Kensington was undergoing this horrific experience of McMansions being built, and nobody who lived here wanted them. And so the small lot ordinance came to be. And among the things that is so important about this ordinance has to do with size, bulk, compatibility. And this project, however attractive looking it is, does not meet the outlined specifics of the small lot ordinance and what is meant to be permitted in Kensington. This house is huge. It is big enough to accommodate, I think, 2.5 of the other sized homes on our street. That is incredibly big. Nobody is entitled to 5 or 7 bedrooms. It's not an entitlement, it's a wish. And by putting 7 bedrooms in this house to accommodate a wish, at the expense of everybody else in our neighborhood, is unwise. And it violates the spirit and the specifics of the small lot ordinance. So thank you very much.
Thank you. All right, who's next? Anybody? Anybody online will have comments, questions, statements, speech?
Yes.
All right. Hi, we can see you and I think we can hear you, so go ahead.
Okay. Hey everyone, my name is Han Qing from 255 Willamette Avenue. My wife Hannah is also here, but she's probably busy with other things, so just me from household. I think everyone had already mentioned the bulk and the scale and the consequences if it got approved in many perspectives. So instead of reiterating the significance of following the regulations, I think I just gonna make some comments on the architect's earlier presentation. So the pictures and diagrams on the house's impact to 255 Willamette, I think those diagrams are very misleading. That's not how we arrange our furniture. So those are from a staging company, right? That's not how we enjoy the space. And just based on the diagrams the architect provided, the viewer's point and the projected views are not how we see the view and see the window from our living room. And we don't stand far away from the window and just be grateful to whatever is visible, right? We use the room very flexible, standing from the window, right? And now to say that you have at least above the ADU, it is a deck, so there is a guardrails, and eventually there will be furnitures, umbrellas, I hope not, and the people using the space. So I think at least the permanent guardrail should be taken into consideration both for the view and for the sunlight. And besides the picture window that you emphasized, the dining room and the kitchen actually have pretty good light currently. The sunlight diagram is also misleading as the street sunlight is not how we experience the daylight, right? I'm not asking for the entire diffuse light 12 hours a day, but I think, you know, this may be a bad analogy, but it's imagining standing behind a big guy and the overwhelming experience of darkness is always unbearable. And now to say the view and the privacy loss to us. And when you comment that, what else you can do? Well, you can reduce the volume of the design, right? I think that is more fundamental than all the design strategies. I was a landscape designer, and now I'm teaching landscape architecture at UC Berkeley, and my wife is a licensed landscape architect. So we believe in the power of design, but I don't think those issues can be addressed purely by design. And more fundamentally, it is the bulk and the scale that changes the ordinance. And the attached ADU is very tricky because we don't see the components differently just because, you know, they have different names or identities. We see one single structure, and currently the house and attached ADU is one single structure. And I don't know if that changes how you file the permit, but that's how it looks and how we see it. I went through the architect's drawings, which I think we should be consistent with how we calculated the lot coverage. Currently it shows about 36%. My understanding is we should include both the permeable and impermeable pavement and all the roof lines and the canopies. And if we do that, it's actually about 69%. So I'm not saying who's right or wrong. I just think we should be consistent with that. And that's pretty much what I want to say. Thank you so much.
Great. Thank you very much. Is there anybody else on Zoom who wants to be heard at this point?
Yes. Can you hear me?
We can hear and see you, so go ahead.
All right, I'm Emily Matthews. I'm the uphill property owner at 140 Purdue. And this project is concerning to us largely just because of the scale of it. It's not in line with the neighborhood. It's just massive compared to everything else. And as it's going to be constructed right in our backyard, we're a little concerned about having some just massive home right behind us. And as it is right now, we can't really see the developable footprint because the story poles are not up. So I think having that would be really helpful for us. But just a 4,700 square foot home being constructed right behind us is not something that we're excited about having happen. A smaller scale would be much more suitable for the neighborhood and less concerning for us. I also have two small kids and I walk down there and I use a stroller. So I've heard a lot of people saying that the roads are already, and the sidewalks are already bad and they're not ADA compliant, but that's not an excuse to make things worse. When I walk down there, I already have a hard time with a stroller going out and around cars and all of that. And now if we're putting in steps or we're putting in a garage that's opening right onto the sidewalk, it's just going to be making it worse. So I don't see that things being bad can be used as a reason to make things worse. If anything, we should be looking at ways to improve things instead of making it worse than it already is. And there's a lot of kids in the neighborhood that are moving in, a lot of babies, a lot of strollers. It seems like there's more every month. And yeah, it's something that we should be thinking about in the future. Yeah, that's all I've got.
Great. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
I wanted to say something.
All right, go ahead. You're on the air.
Hey, this is Steve Caramia. I live at 200 Willamette on the corner. And John is I consider him a good friend of mine. And I was excited about him moving into that space. But John, I'm sorry, that's too big of a house for that little lot. And actually I saw that it's no, I just think it's too much. I would not be in favor of that. Not to mention, someone said 7 bedrooms, meaning 7 cars, even if it's 5 more cars. That's going to be difficult for people. So I would not be in favor of that. Do you want to say anything, Steve? So, yeah. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Anybody else on the air, on Zoom? You want to hear, be heard on Zoom?
Yes.
Okay. I'd love.
Thank you for the opportunity. My name is Carla Sylvie, and I'm the owner of 256 Willamette, where I've been since 2015. And I live with my 13-year-old son who attended Kensington Hilltop. My voice is really adding to the same concerns that other people have raised, but I did want to add my voice to that. So I share the very specific concerns that Arjun and Sarah shared in their slides. With those statistics that really make the size and scale clear. In summary, I'm very concerned about the proposed overall and also relative scale, including that setback variance. So it's because of the parking, it's because of the danger of the lack of setback, the danger and inconvenience of traffic on an already very congested narrow street, and being out of character in the neighborhood. I do support the idea people have raised about seeing full story poles, but I also echo what Honking said, that it seems like more of a scale than a design problem. So I'm not sure that's going to move the needle much. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, last call or next. Anybody on Zoom here want to be heard?
Yeah, I would like to make a quick comment if possible.
Okay. Yeah, we can hear.
Go ahead. Great. I'm John Kramer. I live on Purdue, so I'm not directly impacted by this specific property development, but I'm concerned with the precedent it would set. That the next time somebody wants to build a big property, they'll say, well, that got approved. So I'm more concerned with the precedent in the longer run creep towards bigger and bigger properties that the economics of real estate seem to demand. And that's my input on the bigger picture or longer term concerns. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Anybody, somyone else wanted to speak? I thought I saw, there we go. Hi.
Oh,
we
Hi.
Can, yeah, we can hear you.
Okay, you can hear me. Great. Sorry. I'm Liz. I live at 217 Willamette. Just echoing a lot of the same concerns. I have three boys who are running around this neighborhood. So zero setback sounds really unsafe to me. My youngest is seven. It's already hard to see him. So I could not imagine backing a car out with so many kids in the neighborhood. Other things I wanted to echo is it just doesn't fit with the character of our neighborhood. We moved to Kensington too, specifically because it's like small, quaint, you know, also within the Bay Area. I think if you want seven bedrooms, the place to do that is like Orenda or somewhere where there's a lot of physical space. You know, we have, I'm just going to be echoing here, but the street is already so congested. It's already hard for me to imagine like another house with at least two more cars, I would assume. But I do agree they're going to have more cars. I don't know how many kids they have, but they're going to all turn 16 at some point. Already when I'm driving down the street, you know, I can't make it down the street without having to pull over, move. So having more cars on the street is just going to add to that congestion. So I think that's a problem. I think a seven bedroom house is really two houses in Kensington. I just don't think it fits. I was late to the meeting because we were having dinner, but I don't know as much of what's going on, but it just doesn't sound like it is permittable. So I guess I don't understand why it's a question we're building, or why are we building such a big house if it without setbacks? I feel like the rules should be followed. That's all. Thanks.
Great. Thank you. Oh, we have another caller. Hi, we can see you.
Europe, so it's in the night. I'm sorry, it's dark. My name is Jasmine. I'm going to be the resident of this house, and we're talking about our family house here. I just wanted to say we have four kids. We have lived in Kensington for a few years. My mother-in-law lives on Wellesley.
Oh, it's
and she's been there for 25 years. I feel part of the community. And one thing that I do love about Kensington is the family friendliness. Three of our kids will be going to Kensington Hilltop from August. So I know about the ways to school. I've walked the streets of Kensington a lot, and I also know of other places with zero setback from the sidewalk, and I see how it's not ideal. But I also trust our architect enough to know the impact and you know how to best address this. Hence the reason why Public Works has two examples or options for what we could do. I do hear a lot of concerns about the size. For us, the size is just defined by the size of our family. We do intend to have the ADU. I think the small lot coverage is a great idea. I love Kensington, how it is and was, but also there is a housing crisis in California, and I believe that by law, the ADU is something that is actually being encouraged in California. We are a multi-generational family setting, and we really did our best to address all of the issues and incorporate all of the wishes. Unfortunately, and this is something that I have said before too, is we can't make a new house look old. So it is a new construction, and there's just no way for us to avoid building a house without construction, to actually build a house without construction. So that's just something that I'm very sorry to, that is going to impact everybody in the area, but it's just what comes with a new house. We're still looking forward to being part of the community and living on Willamette. And we'll definitely build those story poles. We only put four story poles up because They indicate the highest point of the house, and that was the biggest concern so far. And yeah, that's basically it. Just making a stand for us here and the family friendliness in Kensington. Yep. So thank you.
Great. Thank you. All right. Who's up? I see a hand. Yeah.
Hi. Actually, I'm not Cynthia, but I'm her husband, Richard. So I'm neighbors with John and Yazi, and we've been living here for 27 years, and we've known his mother, who moved in there about the same time we did. And one good thing I'd say is they are great neighbors. They are so conscientious. You know, they're very handy. They really bring a lot to any neighborhood. And so, you know, it's so nice living next to them. And even, you know, I think they contribute to the whole area where we live on Wellesley. So I know obviously concerns everyone brings up, hey, you know what, when something comes into your neighborhood, everyone's concerned and you're worried. But you know, for what it's worth, they're great people, great family. And you know, and also there is a housing crisis. I agree. I know it's really easy to not want growth. And of course, you know, that street is you're right. It's an awkward street. The whole one side of it, there's no parking. So, you know, this would accommodate their cars, you know, and so at least that's a net zero. I think talking about when someone's kids are going to be 16 is something we don't have to worry about. My kids are adults now. They don't even have cars. You know, by then we're going to all have Uber accounts that are automated, and no one will own cars maybe by the time their kids are 16. So who knows what the future will entail, but I do know that there is a housing shortage, and I think they're great people, but obviously you guys have to work out everything else. So thank you.
Thank you. Thanks. Last call. Anybody? Okay. All right. How long is that? All right. We got somebody in the room?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. Come on. Sorry.
Hi, Mary Downs at 245. So I'm glad about the last comment, because I also wanted to say at least something positive, which was I've met Dean, I've met John, Jasmine. They are very nice people. I appreciate the fact that what they need is a large house, because they are a large family. And we would like to have more young families in Kensington, extended families in Kensington. That's all great. I think if I could sort of summarize what I'm hearing as the comments and from the other neighbors that I've talked to, is the problem is the lot is just not of a size that really can accommodate the size house that they need. The original plan a year ago didn't take up quite so much of the actual lot because it was taller, but that didn't stay with the height requirement. So I think what's been done is to now sort of lower the house and then stretch it both forward and backwards into the lot. And you heard the comments about the sidewalk, which does concern me. I think that is the thing that most concerns me. I want to clarify something that was said. My own setback from the sidewalk is, I measured, it's about 7 feet. I wish it was longer. It's very difficult to get in and out of the garage. My house was built in 1979. There was no variance because there was no Kensington ordinance at that time. It did just complete a remodel, which AMAC recommended a few years ago, and it was now completed. The remodel had nothing to do with the front of the house, so the garage and the driveway were defective. So I don't have zero setback, as was said, and I don't have a new driveway either, as was said. So I would like to be supportive of this project, but and no insult intended, but I think the owners of the lot and John and Jasmine and the kids, I think they've been poorly served by both their previous architect and their current architect in telling them that, yes, there's a way to get the house that they need onto a piece of property that just isn't big enough to support it. And it's unfortunate. There are bigger pieces of property very nearby on Garden Drive. There's some big pieces of property to get better views, but obviously that's not where they're building. So that's what I want to say. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much. Yeah. Okay, so the time I mean it, last fall.
If I can highlight something about the view, really quickly.
Well, I still want to get into a debate.
No, no, no. I just want to tell you a procedural thing.
Sure.
Contra Costi won't let us apply for the ADU until we have the house permit. They are making the permit, their zoning permit for the house, contingent upon the ADU's permit. So we can't actually get a zoning permit from Contra Costa without including the ADU as an ADU. So it's not true that we could come back later. I don't think anyone knew this here, not, you know, trying to blame anyone. We the way it's structured with Contra Costa, and I think I understand it, I'm not sure, but we have to apply for this as a complete structure and then apply for the ADU, but the complete structure will be contingent upon applying for that ADU. So this structure will definitely be a house plus an ADU. There's no ADU that can come after the fact because that will be a second ADU.
Right.
I just wanted to clarify that in terms of procedure.
I think they've gone into this really enough. I think we're okay.
I talked to the planner today. He told me the exact opposite.
Great. Thank you.
It's not what he told me.
All right.
Well, like I'm said, not going to argue with you. Just...
I understand there are differing views on the facts about this particular issue. All right. So the public comment time is now closed, and that leaves us as the board to talk about the situation. Then, deep in thought, so I want to ask you what you think.
Well, I actually have one more question because I wasn't able to look at the interiors as well. The house and the ADU. Is it possible? Are you making it possible that they could be integrated in the future? Or is it impossible to integrate them as one house? Is it truly an ADU where it cannot be integrated?
It's not linked now, and there's a concrete structural wall between the ADU and the house.
So they'd have to break through concrete?
You would have to break through concrete, you have to excavate underneath the house to do so.
Okay.
There's always a way.
I'm just trying to understand.
That's
understanding, is it being built in a way that when you do pass, could they just say, okay, you're making a big house now, I'm just trying to understand that aspect of it as well. That doesn't change some of the bulk aspect, like people talked about. I just want to understand the ability to actually make it a voice event and sort of a house. So,
you
have
the
over
there, right?
Huh?
Not me
passing. You know what I'm saying? Something
we all agree on. I'm clear.
Yeah.
Can I ask, I did not get a notice for this meeting at 276, am I not in the required distance to get notified?
I handed them out, and I usually cut it off as people who I think have a very direct, visible impact. So you'd be impacted by construction, of course, but I think I cut it off maybe at Marty's house.
All right.
My recollection is that it was 300 feet, and it's always been so. Yeah.
Well, what happens is, I'm not going to just spell it wrong.
Yeah.
What the county send out notes is they send them out to everyone within 300 feet.
Right.
They kind of wanted us to send them out to everyone within 100 feet. The county can send those notices out. Our practice has been, since I joined the board 7 years ago, was to pass out notices. People who could conceivably be affected by the project. And that varies from project to project. And if I am wrong, I would love to hear about it because, when you put a pin in the map and then draw a circle that's 300, 600 feet in diameter, that substantially increases the number of residences that would have to be given notice by hand. And why then, are we passing these out again instead of just having the planning department mail out the notices like they do for the other stuff? It's kind of consuming, and we have to bear the cost of printing notices either if not substantial, but if you go to top and central and whatnot, the public copy is really $50.
I think just to piggyback on that, we're doing our best. We're trying to get it out to a lot of people. We do err on the side of caution, you were
almost.
Right. Yes. Right. Because this is not the end of the process. Yes. Yeah. Right. I'm sure you know that. But
your decision influences.
Of course.
Yeah, and so therefore it would make sense that the same people notified by the county when it's almost too late should be notified at this stage. And KMAC used to be helped financially by organizations in the community. So.
Well, no, that's very interesting.
there's definitely no financial help.
And I'm not saying informed that I need to give notes to people who talk 300 feet away. It's far too expensive. I get letters from properties that on the streets that I didn't know existed. So if you believe that we're doing this wrong, I absolutely would love to hear from somebody.
I wouldn't phrase it in because everybody in this room has come because they know they'll be accepted, either by the piggybacking of following the example set by one house, and or for a variety of other reasons. We all live within 300 feet of this, and not all of our neighbors know about it. And if they did, I think this room would be much fuller.
Okay.
Thank you.
Robert, is there going to be great public comments kind of done at this time?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So wait till we're still.
2 and 7 will matter. That's the fourth house up on the north side. I think I'm about 300 feet from the building site. And I had a problem with the kind of erosion of privacy with the upper deck. People who stand up on the upper deck can see in my living room, and I can see them, of course. And also, there's some view impairments, and I'll tell you, bias from the living room and from the hallway heading over the door.
Okay. So, I don't know, Ruel, what do you think?
Well, I don't think we can proceed with making any decisions about this until we have story poles erected that show the true building envelope and really give us a sense of the scale of the project.
No, I happen to agree with you. Plus, I think that even if the story poles go up, that the 4,722 square foot elephant in the room is going to be that the house is just overwhelmingly large for the size of the lot.
Yeah.
We do a lot of, we see a lot of plans where the house goes back and goes up the hill. The design is beautiful. I want to live in that house tomorrow. I just think that it's too big for the lot, and I think that it's too close to the sidewalk. And I think that it's going to mess up the sidewalk even worse. 7 bedrooms on Willamette, there's going to be a fire and people are going to die because they can't get out. I hate to be the one to say that. Also, the property at 7 bedrooms can be sold to a biker gang, and that's not subject to me. So, So anyway, I think that I like the family. I like the family living in the thing in the school and all that stuff. But this is, as I've said in previous correspondence, this is a 100-year decision that we're being asked to make, because I think that when this house is built, it's going to be there. It's going to last. My personal opinion is that we'd love to see some story poles. I don't know if it's going to help my views.
I agree. I think it's a beautiful design. I really like it. I think it would be a great addition to the neighborhood. The garage, way too close to the sidewalk, in my opinion. And the square footage of the house, 7 bedrooms, give or take. They're just too big for that street and that lot. I think we should try to adhere more closely to the small lot ordinance. Story poles, I believe, would be a great help but as Lloyd said, it may not change anything, but at least it would help the neighbors envision what it proposed.
If you were thinking about setting, you know, setback in third stories, I think that a house that walks back the slope and is away from the street, if it turns out that you need a variance request for a third story because everything gets pushed back, you know, without pre-committing, I think that that's something that more people would be able to live with. And I, you know, I can't tell you, it's not, that's really this kind of way outside of what we're supposed to do. But I just think that story polls are no, we're going to have to deal with the bulk of the house and number of bedrooms and how close it is to the street. And it's, for the record, I don't personally care about the tree. I mean, I love the tree. It's our area responsibility. So what would we do? Say no? Like, oh, you can't cut down that tree retroactively? I don't understand why that's in the application, but anyway, I mean, I just think that that's, since it's part of the application, it's something that it should.
Thank you. What are we gonna do? You didn't give us.
So,
I'm gonna differ a little bit from the rest of the group here. I'm gonna say that. I do respect the bulk aspect of these things, but I also do truly believe that we are in a situation where we do need to have greater density in the area. And I understand that that's not always welcome, right? But I do think that it is necessary. And so from a bulk perspective, I have less of a problem with it than the rest of the board, you know? Not saying I don't have a problem with it, but I have less of a problem with it, okay? I do think that there's quite a bit of accommodation that would be necessary to really consider the bulk that's being pursued at this point. I think that you've heard those types of accommodations that would probably need to be done, right? And I'm not even sure what cost that would add to the project, honestly, whether it makes it not feasible simply because of the cost that you have to do to create setback, cut further in, et cetera, right? So I do think that, you know, I'm personally more comfortable knowing that they are two separate structures that are linked together, you know, in some ways, but it's not able to be a huge house. Now, does that solve some of the, you know, car storage issues and stuff like that? Not necessarily, you know, but again, you know, I do think that, you know, having basically two units on the property gives me greater comfort in terms of what we as a community need to accept a little bit of. It's not an apartment building, you know, it is multi-generational housing. That is something that I think we need more of. I want to be on the record saying that it's something that we need as a community, right? I do think that the structure as designed, you know, you are trying to be respectful. I think that the difference between the prior design and this design is significantly better, but there's still some additional accommodations that probably are necessary to address some of the issues that have been brought up. I don't think that you're going to be able to get all the issues covered. And as was said before, there's going to be some kind of compromise here on both sides. And unfortunately, I think the greater compromise is going to be on the homeowner side in terms of making it more palatable for the community around it.
Yeah, I think the story polls will help us with the view issues and of its, you know, at the end of the day.
I would recommend before doing story polls that you potentially try and modify the design further to accommodate some of the feedback that's been presented today, to see whether or not, for example, the setback, et cetera, if those things can be done in an economical way that you can proceed with the project, I'd recommend making those design changes first and then doing story polls so that it's more feasible and that the rest of the community can see how you've accommodated the feedback, how it looks with a design that might be more viable and where you'd be looking for approval from this group. Because I'd say at this point, if you said, I don't care and I want a vote on it right now, you'd have probably the entire board saying no, we would not recommend, right? Without any accommodations. So, but if you could make some accommodations, there might be an opportunity for a divided vote. And I don't think you'll get a full unanimous vote on this one since it's so big.
Could you give us your board's and bullet points that you want
you would like us to improve on? I mean, I kind of guess it, but, you know, it's a lot of effort to make changes and then have to find out something wasn't covering. And then these storage holes were not easy.
No.
It's a pain, you know, to keep doing storage holes so to change the footprint.
Right. Yeah.
So I kind of like to get one thing kind of solved before we move to the next level. I don't mind doing it.
Yeah.
But no, I just don't have to do it like four times. So that, if I hopefully, I never plan on anything, but
yeah.
So you guys would, you know, maybe help us give us the guidance.
I think definitely the setback is one of the biggest.
Oh, the garage.
Yeah. Okay. There needs to be a much more significant setback than this time being proposed.
No, so would that still be within the 20-foot setback? Because really about 20 feet means a 30-foot isolation.
Mm-hmm.
The site goes like this.
Yeah.
Yes, it does.
So the question I have is, are you willing to look at a front yard infringement, but not a zero-foot infringement?
I think that David's pointing about the further back the garage doors are, the easier it will be to mitigate the slope of the sidewalk. That does not mean that it has to be 30 or 50 feet back.
Sidewalk's still going to be.
I think
still going to stairs.
Yeah.
Okay.
We'll see
for a moment that you're right. I'm not saying that, but I was to say that. And there are other homes in the neighborhood with 5, 6, 7 foot setbacks, would help with the safety concerns.
Yeah. I don't think you can prescribe a certain amount, but no, I'd say just that's good. The more the better.
20 foot is probably something between 0 and 20.
Well, we usually vote based on what we see as reasonable and in line with the rest of the neighborhood.
Yeah.
So I think if you guys look at the block, you probably see, you know, like what Larry's house is probably pretty standard.
And while we receive input, and we've received a lot of it tonight, the community by itself doesn't vote on.
Right.
We're basically bound to follow the law, and you know, it's been pointed out points, and I think that most of the objections center on valid concerns that we have to consider. So,
I think that the other things that I heard that were brought up were largely related to the roof, you know, so the top of the structure, and so basically potential reflective issues. So if there's ways to remediate that, privacy issues because it could be used as a deck eventually or something. So like these types of things, that, you know, if you can mitigate those, it removes some of those contentious issues with some people, some of your neighbors. So these are the types of things that I was capturing as I was listening to the feedback. Again, you know, like I think that the biggest thing is that it needs to, like, I think that it needs to be clear that effectively this is two structures, you know, so you're not getting a 4,700 square foot house. You're getting a 2,700 square foot house and then a 2,900 square foot house and then an ADU.
Yeah.
The
board could articulate design recommendations in a motion.
Well, I don't think that
I don't think
things are, we're not there yet.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't think we could say do this, that, and the other things like on a bullet pointed list and then guarantee that it's going to fly the next time it comes around because we got to see what's there.
Yeah.
And I disagree with Ben's characterization of the suitability of this particular project to accommodate 7-bedroom, even if it's two structures. And if it is two structures, my opinion is that that makes it more problematic because it's more likely that persons living on the lot are going to be unrelated and each will have their own means of transportation and everybody wants their own car.
Yeah, and I was only speaking for myself. No, I
wasn't speaking for the board. No, that me too also.
Yeah.
So procedurally, you can request that we vote. You can request a continuance and come back again another day. Obviously we're not asking you to withdraw the application. We don't have the ability to do that, but we're hoping, I think, that you would take the feedback, not just from us, but from everybody who's spoken today, see if you can work that in a way that is affordable, for your clients, because that's everything that we say, do this again and do this differently, stuff like that, is, you know, it runs the mirror. We understand. I understand. It's,
what do you want to do, Dan? Do you want us to vote, or do you want to?
We'll have to come back for
that day. So, yeah, the way this would work is you go through the planning department. Once they have the final packet, they drop it with us, and then we schedule for the next available meeting. And I think that given the concerns that we've heard, that we'll try to paper the neighborhood a little bit more to make sure that everyone has a chance to hear when it comes up.
If you were to vote no, does that prevent this meeting up?
It goes to the county as a recommendation against approval or a recommendation for a denial. And while whatever decision is rendered at this level is appealable to the county planning department and on up to the board supervisors, we like to say that our recommendation is given a fair bit of weight. So it sounds like a continuance. Well, we can't really continue it to a date certain, right? But then that starts you on a clock.
I don't think we have to set a date, do we?
Okay, well, we'll continue it indefinitely. We'll hear from you when you're ready, and the county says, you know, it's ready, and we'll put you back on the agenda as soon as possible. So we'll just do a motion to continue. All right, I move that the 011 Avenue project be completed.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? All right, so no action will be taken on the Willamette project tonight as far as final approval or denial. And we don't know that we'll be back in July. So we'll wait to hear from the county and provide notes. And you guys are neighbors and stuff, you can never.
Are we going to get another notice?
I certainly hope so.
Thank you. Most of us in the neighborhood did not receive anything.
Well, did you?
I did give you a notice. Because I don't know anything you like.
Are we making a decision about 262 and Label Drive?
That's the next one. But I will check and see if, and this is, there's less urgency, I think, because. It's already been done, so there's no construction costs or people waiting. It's like we got to look at.
Thanks for record.
Are we moving it up the next meeting, or are we just?
I don't. Do we have any other questions?
Do we have any? What is it? No, it's. We do. So.
I know that we
agenda. All right. So officially, I move that we continue to 262 Lake Drive. The only reason we couldn't hear tonight is because of unavailability of the applicant. In that case, I think we'll just kick it to our next meeting and deal with it.
Did the applicant say they couldn't make the meeting?
Yes. Who is the
person that's not here?
Good question. I thought that your correspondence with somebody about it was going to be 4 a.m. for them. Was that related to this?
I think that was that.
That was Jack.
That was it? Okay.
Okay.
So
we have an unavailability of the applicant.
Because I delivered all those notes, I delivered it to them as well.
Okay.
I mean, that doesn't mean that you can't render judgment on the project.
That's true.
Right.
We haven't adjourned, you know. Let's go for it, man.
I just can't tell what it is. Like the print down had the whole time.
Yeah, it's all plans are all. Well, at least in my packet, it's like.
They're just so super blown up.
You can't decipher them.
Yeah. I don't even know what to put
up. Do you have the cardboard or not?
Yeah, is there electronic?
Yes. Yes. Let's see if we can do that.
Okay. Thank you.
Knock it out.
Something must have just happened.
Okay. But yes, we are going to do one more thing today.
You guys don't have to stay on if we don't want to. We're not talking about zero line.
In the absence of a request for public hearing, I'm surprised that this wasn't handled administratively.
Yeah, 50
unless it goes straight. What do you think? Mail on license? Just be versus.
I just can't tell what it is.
Can we do it okay tonight?
I think we should
give it a
shot.
I guess we did.
We didn't build something already.
Yeah. Already built, and they want to approve.
Right. Extra 50 square feet. Maybe they bought a house of those.
Project
well, if we can't answer that question, then we can't.
262 Lake Drive. Mm-hmm.
That's that one, I think you got it.
Yeah, it looks like.
Yeah.
So it's 2750 square feet of gross floor, where 2700 square feet is the threshold for the property.
Yeah.
This is, I guess, where it is on the street.
We can scroll it down.
Yeah, that's such a location.
Okay, so.
Hold on one second.
ADU conversion. It looks like. Plan.
That's that little spot in the back corner. Converted deck.
Yeah, it's a problem. It's just need one more time. Also, is it below the house? Is it?
Here we go.
It looks like it's the lower level.
This right here?
Yeah.
I could just send everybody this link and you can review it before the next meeting. I mean, I realize this is a small project, but
we need to know what it is.
Exactly.
I mean, it says ADU conversion, but where is the 50 square feet that we're?
Yeah. Well, there's nobody's here to answer our question.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm okay with
it. I'm fine hunting it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. So, motion, we continue. We're going to continue.
Second.
All right. Can you pause? All right.
Thank you. Have a good day.
So, how about what's the other word?
Motion to adjourn. I'll second.
Okay. Thank you all very much for your service.
I need to vote.
No, I don't want to adjourn. Let's stay here and hash it out.
Yeah. All right. So, what? So, you're going to send us the link?
Yes, I will. Great. That was some heavy duty work.
That was. The longest we've had in a while.
It was
definitely the most crowded.
Oh, did we didn't say what the time was? Adjourn at 8:52.
There it is. Official. And now we stop.